WROI, WROIFM.com. Streaming audio live on RTC Channel 5. Audio and soon to be video on RTC Channel 4. Yes, indeed. Scott's back with us. Hey, Scott, how you doing?
Good,
Tom. All right. John Alley is also in the studio from Woodlawn Hospital.
Good morning.
President, CEO. Good morning.
Good morning. We're back to the rain again. I guess it dried up that one day, so we decided a little more moisture wouldn't hurt anything.
We need the rain, right?
Yes.
Sure we do.
Right.
Anyway, it's starting to clear a little bit right now, which
looking
is a good sign.
Looking good out there.
Yeah.
I hope we heard a nasty word. Maybe, possibly, there might be snow back in the forecast.
Of course, we're looking at the end of February, 1st of March, so that is typical Indiana weather,
yeah,
right?
Absolutely.
Trustees in session yesterday from Woodlawn Hospital.
Had our board meeting yesterday, and first of the year, again, not a lot going on as, you know, we're trying to clean up the last year and kickstart the new year. So just a couple things, you know, I did bring the board up to speed on. One of them is, you know, we've been getting some comments, are we still under the visitation restriction for those 18 and younger? And yes, we are. We're still seeing quite a bit of the flu come into the building, so enable to help protect the patients and also the kids. To keep them, you know, not exposed to the flu bug. Probably, we're hoping maybe another week and a half, we'll get the clearance from CDC that we can probably lift that visitation. So just be aware, we're still restricting nobody under the age of 18 visiting. Amen. If you're there for, you know, to seek medical treatment, that's fine. But we want to protect the patients and the kids. So we do ask that, you know, not bring the kids in right now.
Is it waning? Is the flu
waning? We're starting to see a decline in it. And, you know, it was one of those we kept hearing, well, next week. And we've been...
Boy, it's been a long haul.
We've been hearing that for 3 weeks. So we have started seeing a little bit of a downturn in the number of folks presenting with flu-like symptoms. So we're hoping kind of through the worst of it on the tail end of that whole problem.
Okay.
And once we get to that point where we start seeing, you know, fewer and fewer folks coming in with the flu... Then we'll lift that restriction and, you know, start letting the kids back in the building. And we know it's been an inconvenience for a lot of folks. You know, the mom's in the hospital, the dad's in the hospital, and the kids want to see them. And we apologize, but we just can't expose everybody to that flu. We're trying to keep it under control.
Better safe than sorry.
And most folks have been very understanding when we've told them. They didn't like it, but they understood.
Sure.
So hopefully next week or so we can lift that and get back to normal visiting and, you know, get the kids back in the building. They're kind of fun to see at times.
Okay.
The other thing that kind of had probably the longest discussion on at the board is that we've been seeing a fairly dramatic increase in bad debt from our self-pay patients on very, you know, on orthopedic cases and stuff like that. And we've put off and just hoped we didn't have to do it, but we're going to start requiring some self-pays to do a deposit, at least to help cover the implant cost on some of those cases. And unfortunately, you know, if you have a hip replacement, knee replacement, the cost to us just of the device that we're putting in is $10,000, $12,000, $15,000, $20,000. So, you know, when we start not getting any payment on those, that adds up pretty quickly. So the board, we finally did agree that starting April 1st, we'll be requiring a deposit for any elective procedures for patients who are self-pay. Now, we have several options to those folks who don't have insurance. You know, we do have our compassionate care program. All we ask is you fill out some paperwork. If you qualify for that, then, you know, we'll write off that charge because you meet the criteria for that program. There are several other programs we have available. We have the claim aid people there to help find insurance for you. So this really is only going to affect, we think, a fairly small portion, but what's happened in that small portion has been a fairly large dollar amount for us. So, you know, if it's a medical necessity, it's not an elective procedure, again, we're going to do that procedure. These are just for those things that are elective and you're truly self-pay, have, you know, no insurance or anything whatsoever. We're going to ask for a deposit on that money. So the doctors aren't real happy with that, and I understand their job is to treat the patient.
Provide the treatment.
Provide the treatment, but they kind of understand that, you know, there is a cost involved in that. So I'm guessing we'll have some complaints on that, but starting April 1st, we'll kind of start doing that and then phase it in, and hopefully people understand, and we do have, like I say, a lot of programs. If, you know, you need assistance, all you have to do is ask. We can find somebody to help you or a program that you will probably qualify for that'll allow you to have your procedure, but again, allow us at least get partial payment to cover the cost of that procedure. And then we came from there right into the financials. Gross revenue for the month was about $11.6 million. Wrote off $7 million. Had operating expenses of $4.8 million. We had some non-operating revenue, which is sources outside of operations of the hospital.
Is this December, John?
This would be for January.
For January,
this
okay.
This is January.
Okay.
Of about $297,000. So we did post a profit for the month of $220,000, which for this time of year is kind of unusual. And I think a lot of that has to do with the flu. We had a lot of folks in the building with that flu as an inpatient and a lot of outpatient procedures, visits, because of the flu. So,
well, I was noticing your gross revenue was up.
It was up, too.
In the month of January.
In the month of January.
Right.
And again, we saw quite a few people came in, and you kind of go back and we start looking at what was the primary diagnosis for all those visits. Right. It was either flu-related or, a variation of that. So I think that, unfortunately hit everybody really hard this year. Flu vaccine wasn't very effective. Those who, we had some folks say, well, I got the flu shot and I still got the flu. Yeah, you did, but the issue there was that probably wasn't as severe.
Right, lessened the symptoms.
It lessened that a little bit. So we're still saying, even though it might not have been 100% effective, we did see those folks who had the flu shot. If they did get the flu, it wasn't quite as bad as for those folks who did not get the flu shot. That's the ones that came in and was actually hospitalized. And it can be very serious. I mean, it's a very serious respiratory issue. So, again, as we look to next year, hopefully, the CDC will guess right. And that's what they do. They guess what they think the flu strain is going to be. But, we highly encourage get the flu shot, even though everybody said, well, got it this year and it didn't do any good. Yeah, it did. It does help solve some of those issues, soften up the flu.
Can we ever get a flu shot that will actually take care of the flu? Wouldn't that be nice?
One size fits all. If we could find that.
Right.
But I think, the problem with the flu virus, it mutates.
Right.
And it changes year after year. So,
Never quite the same.
So, the variation or the base strain stays the same, but it changes and evolves. And I think, the CDC does the best they can to try to say, okay, what do we think is going to be the one for, coming up? Because they start making the vaccine well before flu season. And unfortunately, this year, they just guessed wrong.
Right.
And, so we've had quite a few deaths around the country from the flu.
Sadly.
And when you start, looking at some of those, a lot of those folks, again, did not get the flu shot. And it really hits you hard. So, yes, you can still get the flu with the flu shot, but it's not as bad as if you didn't get it. So we do recommend, as we look to next year, absolutely get with your healthcare provider, get your flu shot. Even if it's not 100% effective, it still protects you.
Excellent.
And that was pretty well the board meeting. It was a very short meeting, not a lot going on. We're, gearing up for 2018, tweaking the budget a little bit. We think we're going to be very close. When we looked at our budget expenses for January against actual, we only missed it by $20,000. So it tells me that the staff has done a real good job of projecting what they think their expenses are going to be, and we got real close to that on actual. So revenue's the hard one. You just don't know who's going to come, how many patients you're going to have, how much sickness you're going to have. Our expenses are almost fixed because we have to staff the same number of people, whether we have one patient or we have 25, just because you never know when you're going to have, some folks come in.
February's a little shorter month, John. Will that matter?
Not really, because we budget that same way. So our anticipation is we're going to see less revenue because there's fewer days in the month. So we kind of, try to match the days in the month to what our projections are. We're hoping, again, to hit budget. We actually, unfortunately, budgeted a loss for the month of January. So we got a little bit of a cushion if we miss
some.
It's a good start, and I hope we can keep that up because, even though we're, classified as a not-for-profit hospital, we still need to show a profit because what we do, we take those profits and turn them back into new programs, new equipment, and upgrades to serve the community.
John Alley's president, CEO of Woodlawn Hospital, talking about the Board of Trustees meeting yesterday and certainly other things affecting Woodlawn Hospital. And John, I remember towards the end of last year, maybe middle part of last year, we had a discussion about drugs and prescriptions and things like that and whether or not hospitals were going to be able to get the particular medicines that they needed. And I think a lot of that had to do with the storm in Puerto Rico.
Absolutely.
And I wondered if that had changed any, if we were getting back to normal or if we're still in that same situation.
We're not back to normal, but we're not as bad as we were. So we're starting to see an uptick in the production of those. One of the things that really helped us is that the U.S. the drug folks, DEA, allowed some stuff from Europe to come over. Of temporarily. They said until U.S. production gets back up to speed, you know, they did temporarily approve some of the IV bags and IV solutions. So that helped a little bit. We're starting to see some of them come back online and not getting 100% over. So if we order 10 cases, we might get two. So we're still being very conservative and not wasting stuff. I think the biggest thing we're going to see in 2018 is on the opioids, the narcotic drugs. They have restricted production on that. And every year, you know, they say, here's how much you can make. They've reduced that by 25% for 2018. So once that allotment's done, they can't make any more. So the physicians are now having to be very careful, knowing that there's a short supply of some of those painkillers. And the unfortunate is some folks really need them, but we've got that small, that 20% that abuses it that affects the other 80% that really do need it.
That's still a big number, that 20%.
It's still a big number.
Sure.
And we are having a lot of abuse of the opioids, not only here, but across the country. Right. So that has been what, they just said, okay, we're going to restrict that. If we don't have them, you can't prescribe them. So the physicians are kind of in that bind that they got to figure out alternatives for some folks. And so, we've been doing that, and we get calls from other ERs saying, hey, so-and-so was just here. They're coming your way. Because, unfortunately, they're trying to find a source to, get the narcotics that they want, and they're just not available. They're just not giving them out. And, there's not a lot we can do. They get mad at us, but, again, our hands are tied on a lot of this anymore.
Do some of these have shelf life?
Yes, most of them always do. So, okay. The shelf life or what they say, here's the expiration date on this drug, I think they're very conservative. Because, unfortunately, a lot of the drugs here that we turn back in that have expired, they ship them overseas, and they use them just fine over there. But, again, that's the rules we have to play by, and so, it keeps it safe for here. We're much stricter on our healthcare regulations here than any other country. Sometimes that's a good thing, sometimes that's a bad thing. But that's our, sandbox we got to play in, and keeps it safe for all the patients.
As you look ahead through 2018, John, any particular big-ticket items that might be coming along for Woodlawn Hospital?
Not really. When we looked at our capital budget, we've got about $400,000 to $600,000 of capital improvements that we've identified. These probably need to be done. We have to do a three-year capital to give to the federal government every year. It says, how much in capital improvements do you anticipate over the next 3 years? So we kind of divide that up. So the directors get together and say, here's my wish list. Okay, year one, year two, year three. So we kind of look at those. What is the most critical? We put that year one. Next critical, year two, and it would be nice to have. We put that in year three. As we move to year three, some of that stuff, we'll move up to the year one. So nothing big. It's just a lot of little maintenance items that we're going to have to look at, and they're critical items, air handlers, some new chiller components that keep the building either warm or cool. And you just can't do without it, and that stuff's expensive. It doesn't get cheaper each year. So we're hoping to, stay within that capital budget, not have any emergency repairs. So the board approves that capital. But again, if we have an item that breaks that, has to be repaired before a board meeting, then they do authorize us. Go ahead and you can expend that. Just let us know at the board meeting, and they'll approve it at that point. But most everything that we do run by the board. Any major purchase goes by them. They have to approve it before we can go ahead and do that, which is a nice check and balance.
Finally, John, I wanted to ask you about Affordable Care Act and how we're still getting along with that.
I think that's still working. A lot of the portions that was dropped did not affect us. We have seen some folks, though, because of the insurance companies getting out of that market, a lot of folks who had coverage last year do not have it this year. There's just nothing available for them. So, we're trying to work with them through that claim aid. Are there other programs than state programs that we can get them into to get them some sort of catastrophic coverage, if nothing else? So it was a little bit of a hit for us. We did bump up our anticipated bad debt for 2018, knowing that a lot of the folks that were in the marketplace are now out of that. We don't think it's going to be like it was 5-6 years ago where we had just a tremendous amount of folks with no insurance whatsoever. There are some programs out there, state-level programs, that they will qualify for. So we're trying to help them get enrolled in that. And it's a complicated process. So if you're looking for that, please contact the claim aid representative at the hospital.
They are very helpful.
They know what forms need to be filled out and can help you walk through that process and make it as the least painful that they can and get you some sort of coverage.
Any agenda items for March yet, John?
Not yet.
Okay.
We're hopefully no major capital items, and just kind of move forward and hopefully keep on budget. We've got a fairly conservative budget for 2018. Again, a positive bottom line. We want to strive to make that. Get a little more aggressive. We're looking for 2019 already, our budget for that year, and we want to bump up our expectations to try to make a little better bottom line for the hospital, because we do have some things we would really like to do. Some of the patient rooms are the rooms when that hospital was built. They're needing an upgrade, and that's going to be expensive. So I don't want to borrow money to do that. I want to have the funds available, so when we do that upgrade, we don't have to borrow money, don't have to go in debt, we can pay cash for it. And that process, probably a 3 to 4 year, because I can only do a small amount of rooms at a time. Can't take them all out of service. So we're trying to build our cash up to start that project 2019, maybe late 2019, and maybe take 3 rooms, renovate those, and then start working our way through the facility.
Catching fish in the pond?
There is some folks fishing already. past couple days, we've seen some folks out there.
John Alley, President and CEO of Woodlawn Hospital, thank you so much for the visit this morning. We appreciate it. Keep up the good work keeping Fulton County and the surrounding area healthy.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.